the public, the civil society, the educator, the journalists. So, as the UNESCO said, it is the education is our responsibility. And that's why we have all of us to contribute. Without networking, partnership, advocacy, awareness, we will not be able to change the culture. In some countries, the culture is obstacle. In some countries, the funding is difficult. In some countries, there is the policies. Yes. And this will not be changed unless there is a collective action from all partners.
Transformation is afoot. It's fundamentally altering the way we approach development. For decades, wealth grew but left out many from the prosperity. Cities flourished, but they're unsustainable. The pace of the fourth industrial revolution threatens to worsen inequality and unsustainability. The response against these ills is reshaping how businesses and corporates create value, how public services are delivered, how funds and investments are made, how leaders envision their organization's future. The tide is shifting to social impact leadership. Social entrepreneurs set up businesses that do well by doing good. People spearhead innovative solutions in public service delivery. They introduce a theory of change, measure their impact, and serve more citizens. Impact first investors rise, prioritizing their impact on society over returns on investments. They are a new breed of leaders, rebels against the status quo, change makers. Join us at the Asian Institute of Management's Master in Development Management. Learn more about us at our website.
Coastal waters are home to some of the most critical ecosystems on Earth. They sustain life, support jobs for millions of people worldwide, feed communities and countries, and are vital to addressing climate change. But these are troubled waters in troubled times. Chronic overfishing is the most immediate and widespread threat to ocean life. And the collapse of coastal fisheries jeopardizes the economic and food security of rural communities around the world. Revitalizing our oceans and the communities that depend on them means finding a balance between use and conservation, between fishers' needs today and their community's long-term prosperity. Fish Forever is RARE's community-led solution to coastal overfishing. Fish Forever inspires communities to work together to protect coastal habitats that sustain their fisheries and empowers fishers with a sense of pride in their responsible fishing behaviors. Fish Forever means fish for the reef, fish for families, fish for jobs. Fish Forever means fish for life. RARE inspires change so people and nature thrive.
Kayang magawa ng paraan. bago ako naging bahagi ng GK, isa akong fishbowl vendor na kumikita ng 150 kada araw. Ang 150 na ito ay para sa 5 kong anak. Napakahirap kasi kahit tamang pagkain, halos hindi kong matustusan.
Pag-ilong bukong it maayos ko ako nung hindi ako pwedeng akigan dahil bisan na kung sa kung yapon lumaiso.
Pananaw po namin noon, nung pumasok si GK, hindi-Christianize po kami. Hanggang sa naipaintindi ni GK kung ano yung mga layunin niya. Si GK po kasi, siya po yung parang naging daan po sa amin. Na hanggang sa lumaki, yung pananaw po is may pag-asa na ipunla sa puso ko, bata pa lang ako. Bukod sa binigyan po kami ng bahay tsaka lupa, every Saturday, Sunday may pumupunta sa baryo namin, nagpapakain sa amin. Dinadala kami sa Jollibee. Yun po yung first experience po namin na pumasok sa Jollibee nung 10 years old po kami.
Noong 2015 po, narinig ko po sa lugar namin, may usap-usapan po na meron po libreng paaralan dito sa Angat, Bulacan. Yung school po is SEED, School for Experiential and Entrepreneurial Development. One of the first school that teaches social entrepreneurship in the whole country. Social entrepreneurship po is basically po a business na kailangan may social impact po para sa community. Dumidirekta na po kami sa mga farms malapit sa GK Enchanted Farm and wala na pong porsyento para sa mga middlemen po.
Isang araw, naging challenge sa amin is kailangan namin mag-isip ng product na gagawing kabuhayan. Naisip kong pwede kong gawing kabuhayan ang peanut brittle na may iba't ibang flavor. Umatok ito sa mga bisita ng Enchanted Farm, kaya tinulungan nila akong maging negosyo ito. Kaya pinapasitin ako sa SEED program kahit ako lang ang nakakatanda sa mga batang kasabay ko noon. Yun po, nag-offer din po yung GK management kung kailangan ko ng financial. Pero tinanggihan ko po yung gusto ko pong alisin sa mga mayayaman namin na guests na yung mahihirap po is naghihintay lang ng donation. Kaya po hindi ko po kinuha yung pera. Ngayon po, kumikita po yung aking negosyo ng 20,000 a month. Nakapagpatapos ko ng isang college. At the same time, nakakapagtabi po ako ng pera sa bangko. Nung gumraduate po yung anak ko, naiyak po talaga ako kasi hindi ko po talaga ini-expect na yung elementary graduate na kagaya ko is nakapagpag-graduate ng high school.
Bago kami makasugod sa GK Village, umagi kami sa value formation activities. Tinuran kami kung anuro mayayad nga pakipag-iba sa kapwa. Pag so seminar ko sa Gawad Kalinga Agro, pag volunteer ko sa Gawad Kalinga sa GK, ay mabaho ka ako nga pagbago sa akong pagkatao mo karon. Aniro yun na ako ng bago tanan nga, ipa, ano ko na yung pamilya bago, nagpakita ko man yun sa bilog ng community nga royal na akong pagbago siya sa Sudit Village. Araw malisod ka akong do, pag umpisa ko, pag KB President akong do, pag abot iya kamon ko, Typhoon Yolanda. Sobrang masubo dahil nadugaan kami at bagay ang pangabuyan. Yung mga uwat bagay, nagkasarili at bagay, tapos iya sa Sudit Bilis, nagkaroon sanda eh, hanap buhay, doon do, pag bago man iya sa among komunidad.
nagtanim ka sa puso ng mga bata na may hirap ng pag-asa. And yun po yung halaga ni GK sa amin. Napaglaki namin, kami naman po yung magmahal sa community po namin. Pag pumasok ka po doon, hindi ka matatakot kung Kristiyano ka man or anumang lahi mo. Kasi kami po, sa amin po sa GK Slum Village, wala po kaming pinipiling tao.
Sa GK, nakukuha ko yung respeto. Kahit hindi pa ako nakapag-aral, tinuruan po nila ako na magtiwala sa sarili at makihalubilo sa iba't ibang klaseng tao.
Bukod niyang it manggaranon sa kwarta, puno man ipagaong sa bawat isaga. Umpisa sa pamilya at sa mga inunga. Sarakamon, sobra pa sa bagay kabuhian ang pagkaon ruging daga at gawad dalinga sa patima. Hindi maparisan ro mga regalo ang kasadya ang pagkaon at pamilya na binigyod at gawad dalinga para kaamong tanan.
Ang pinakamahalagang aral ng tutunan ko ay hindi lang mangarap para sa sarili kundi para sa bayan. Pag nangarap ka para sa ibang tao at alam mo hindi lang para sa iyong kinikilos mo, parang mas magiging matapang ka kasi alam mo na hindi lang isang buhay yung nakataya sa'yo. I want to eradicate poverty for myself, my community, and my country.
Ako po si Lauren Lidduan.
Ako po si Susan Benson.
Ako si Cirilo Arguelles.
My name is Angelica De Leon.
And I am GK.
La convention relative aux droits de l'enfant, mon pays a ratifié cette convention et nous avons le code de l'enfant où on dit qu'on doit nous impliquer dans la prise de décision qui nous concerne. Et donc il y a des ONG, il y a des associations, il y a aussi le Parlement des enfants de Guinée qui est une grosse instance où les enfants prennent la parole au nom de tous les enfants de leur pays et donc il faudrait les impliquer davantage. Il faudrait donner la chance aux enfants eux-mêmes de porter leur voix et ne pas venir porter leur voix à leur place.
We tend to think of education problems as only being solved through education solutions, but let us not forget that the education agenda, the SDG agenda, is all about intersectoral linkages. What poor African countries do not have the capacity to do is spend a lot on supporting through their budgets the poorest families, through policies that are there to support the basic income of the poorest populations. And we know that such interventions, if they are expanded, they can increase access for the poorest children, but then also decentralizing properly and empowering local governments to take responsibility and monitoring their performance and making sure that resources go to where countries, where the local communities are lagging most behind.
The education is different from any other fields. All the people have something with the education, the community, the parents, the private sector, the public, the civil society, the educator, the journalist. So, as the UNESCO said, it is the education is our responsibility, and that's why we have all of us to contribute. Without networking, partnership, advocacy, awareness, we will not be able to change the culture. In some countries, the culture is obstacle. In some countries, the funding is difficult. In some countries, there is the policies. Yes. And this will not be changed unless there is a collective action from all partners.
transformation is afoot. It's fundamentally altering the way we approach development. For decades, wealth grew but left out many from the prosperity. Cities flourished, but they're unsustainable. The pace of the fourth industrial revolution threatens to worsen inequality and unsustainability. The response against these ills is reshaping how businesses and corporates create value, how public services are delivered, how funds and investments are made, how leaders envision their organization's future. The tide is shifting to social impact leadership. Social entrepreneurs set up businesses that do well by people spearhead innovative solutions in public service delivery. They introduce a theory of change, measure their impact, and serve more citizens. Impact first investors rise, prioritizing their impact on society over returns on investments. They are a new breed of leaders, rebels against the status quo, change makers. Join us at the Asian Institute of Management's Master in Development Management. Learn more about us at our website.
Coastal waters are home to some of the most critical ecosystems on Earth. They sustain life, support jobs for millions of people worldwide, feed communities and countries, and are vital to addressing climate change. But these are troubled waters in troubled times. Chronic overfishing is the most immediate and widespread threat to ocean life. And the collapse of coastal fisheries jeopardizes the economic and food security of rural communities around the world. Revitalizing our oceans and the communities that depend on them means finding a balance between use and conservation, between fishers' needs today and their community's long-term prosperity. Fish Forever is RARE's community-led solution to coastal overfishing. Fish Forever inspires communities to work together to protect coastal habitats that sustain their fisheries and empowers fishers with a sense of pride in their responsible fishing behaviors. Fish Forever means fish for the reef, fish for families, fish for jobs. Fish Forever means fish for life. RARE inspires change so people and nature thrive.
Pagilong bukon it maayos ko ako no. Hindi ako pwedeng agigan dahil bisan ako sa pagyapon dumaiso.
Good morning, everyone. We are so happy to have you with us today. Welcome to the Zero Poverty, Encouraging Rural Development to Reduce Regional Inequalities breakout session. So again, we are very happy that you are here with us this morning, and we're excited to have an engaging conversation on people and their experiences on how they have been able to develop rural progress in the many varied aspects and components of it. My name is Jen De Yomano Santos. I will be your facilitator for this morning. I am from Bantay Kalikasan of the ABS-CBN Foundation. So as we start, I'd like to engage you in a quick poll just to have a sense of who we are here, where we're from, the sectors we're representing. So just a 1 minute quick poll that will be up shortly. So if we can ask you to please go ahead and answer the poll just for us to see the industry you're from. What you're looking for in the summit. It's so exciting. I've been hearing a lot of great interactions coming from the different sessions yesterday and today. And as we face this new difficult path and changes in the world, it really is through learning and collaboration and innovation that we can overcome the many challenges we are facing. So great to see the results coming in. We still have a few minutes for those who haven't yet given their answers. A lot of people are from the NGO, nonprofit sector. We also have a couple who are students, so that's good to know. A few from the government sector. That's great. Half of us are here to learn, and that's good. But we do have a couple also who want to collaborate already, begin some partnerships, begin the conversations on partnerships and networks. Okay, this is great. I see a lot of people are also wanting to do community empowerment, education. Majority are really into the advocacy of sustainable development. So for our speakers, that's good to know, like the people who are in this breakout room. Okay, so we will end the poll now so that we can get all of the results. All right, so we're going to go ahead and share the results. So from the industry sector that our participants are from, so again, the majority of the people with us today are from NGOs and nonprofits. I wonder if the others who answered others in this question, if you can also chat and type in the answer or the sector you're actually part of in the chat boxes. In the chat box, we would really greatly appreciate it. 51% are here to learn, just like me. And we also have people who are, again, looking for partnerships and collaboration. Those are 18 and 13% respectively. And as for our main advocacy, 31% of you said that you are in sustainable development, 15% are in community empowerment, and of course, 18% are also wanting to help each other so that we can do and end poverty. Thank you, Jerry. Yes, you're from the private sector. Got it. Thank you. Okay, so we will begin. And we are very blessed to have with us three sharers who will start the conversation as we talk about rural development and the many ways that we can actually do that, the different components of ending inequality and really developing rural landscapes. For our first speaker, so we'll just get right into the meat of this breakout session. Our first speaker is Mr. Paul Cuenca. Paul is the CEO and Managing Director of Basay Wood Renewables. Dreams to convert 6,000 hectares of forest land into a sustainable forest management model. The project wishes to transition into a green economy, and concurrently, Basay Woods is organizing local communities to provide employment, training, education, livelihood initiatives, and to empower them to be part of the solution. So without further ado, I'd like to turn over the digital space to our first speaker, Mr. Paul Cuenca.
Hello.
Hi, Paul. We can hear you now.
Yeah. Yes. Thanks for the opportunity to share our story today. So I'd start with the presentation. Can you please go to the first slide? Okay. So Basay Wood Renewables is our company. We started out as a logging company, but now we have transitioned to a forestry management.
Hi, Paul. We'll just wait for the slides to come up. Okay, I don't seem to hear Paul. Hello. Okay, I think you're still on mute, Paul. Let's go back to.
There you go.
Great. Okay.
Next slide, please. This is the area that we have. It's in this yellow area right here. We are in the southwest corner of Samar Province, and we're 1 hour away from Tacloban City. Next slide, please. Okay, in order to come up with a master plan, we had to commission a situational survey and analysis, doing physical site assessment, biodiversity assessment, climate disaster risk assessment, socioeconomic assessment. Next slide, please. Okay, the baseline numbers that we get essentially shares the size and the scale of this project. We have 3,526 hectares of area. We have 50 years concession from the DENR. We have less than 20% of the forest that is still intact. And there are 7,500 people in and around the development area. Next slide, please. We came up with a SWOT analysis. The strengths are, we have a large contiguous area that is good for plantation. There are no land disputes. We have a government approved agenda. It's relatively flat topography, and we are in within a watershed area. The weaknesses are lack of infrastructure, lack of skilled labor, and lack of basic utilities. Opportunities that we see: we can do full organic certification. We are close to a natural park. There's available government financing for planting activities. And then we have very good relations with the people people's organizations in the area. The threats: it's a typhoon prone area. There's NPA activity, and it's susceptible to climate change hazards. Next slide, please. So with that information already, we came up with an integrated area development master plan, which is anchored on four pillars of development. First would be a tree plantation. Secondly would be a community development plan. The next would be a community-based ecotourism. And then D would be a climate change mitigation program. Next slide, please. For the tree plantation, we're looking at 50% of the inventory to be at fast-growing trees, 25% would be at bamboo, rattan, and abaca, and 25% would be high-value crops and agroforestry plantations. Next slide, please. For community development, we will provide stable employment for the people within the area, skills training, livelihood development, giving them dual income households, education for the youth, proper medical facilities for health, and also quality of life for the people within it. Clean water, toilets, you know, electricity and cell phone connectivity. These are basics for quality of life. Next slide, please. You know, there's a lot of positives that can come out of this for ecotourism. We would like to do community-based ecotourism and model it after the U.S. national park system. Okay, next slide, please. Climate change is also a big problem in the area, so we would like to do the mitigation through reforestation by planting old growth trees like yakal, lawaan, and so forth. All of the energy we would like to use within the area would be through renewable energy sources, so through solar, biomass, and mini hydro. And then we'd like to do a closed loop ecosystem where we essentially recycle everything that we use. And then set up a carbon credit scheme. And then, of course, to do landscape restoration. There's a lot of kaingin activity in the area. So we'd like to do some soil regeneration and repairing the damaged landscapes through replanting and reforestation. Next slide, please. This is our proposed development zone. So we'd like to look at this by developing it phase by phase because of the scale of the project. And then we'd like to look as, we'd like it to look like a special economic zone model. So we do this zone by zone. We do it step by step, depending on the amount of investment that we get for the area. Next slide, please. And we will achieve all of this through an ecosystem of collaboration. We are open and encourage open collaboration because the project is big enough, there's enough room for everyone. So we'd like to invite, educational institutions, international NGOs, local NGOs, private companies, and even future collaborators to come in and help the development of our area. And that's the end of my presentation.
Thank you, Paul. It's nice to know that the big dream that you have for this area. I would like to invite everybody to go ahead and please put your questions in the chat box. But we will have a few minutes right after each presentation for some questions. But we will also have some more in-depth discussion after all three presentations have been made. So again, if you have some questions, we don't have a lot of time for this breakout session. So I do hope that you can go ahead and type in the questions in the chat box, specifically for Paul's presentation. So go ahead and we can read it out for you. Or you may also want to raise your hand and we can call you out if you have a question that you would want to address to Paul. So as we wait for that, maybe Paul, I could start off the short Q&A at this moment for some questions. So currently in the model that you have presented, where are you now in that project cycle?
We're still in the planning stages. We were supposed to have started this year because of the pandemic, of course, everything had to be delayed. So we're looking at first quarter of next year to start our operations.
Okay, what was the main social issue or the main need that you saw that prompted you to come up with this rural development plan?
I think the main issue was that the area was already denuded and there was a lot of poaching or illegal logging. And then also there was a lot of incidents of, kaingin, slash and burn. And then also the area when we saw
I think there are moments when we lose Paul because of internet connection. But I think it's very clear that one of his inspirations for doing this is really the current state of the environment in the area.
Correct.
Is that correct, Paul?
Yeah.
Yes. There's a question in the chat box. Where exactly, again, is the project in Basay?
It covers five different barangays. It's Inuntan, Mandilina. it's actually there in the map.
Okay, so maybe we can go back and just show. I think some people are quite interested to know where exactly is the location of this development project. So is it correct, Paul? This is 6,000 hectares.
The first parcel that we have is 3,000 hectares. We have another 3,000 available that can be given to us by the DNR. We will start with this first parcel first.
The first 3,000 is it with a tenurial instrument with government, or is it a privately owned
There are no tenurial instruments within the area. So there are no, as I said, walang disputes dito on the land. So it's basically clear from farming and from people living in it. Yes.
I see a lot of messages coming in saying, wanting to know exactly how they can help, the kind of help that you need. So maybe we can also just quickly go through that as well, Paul. And there are people who are offering actually some capacity building, skills training. Is that something that you also foresee as a need and a source of partnership for this project?
Yeah, as I said, we welcome any partnership in this regard. They can shoot an email to me or I can talk to them afterwards. And as I said, we're open and encourage this kind of collaboration at all. You know, that's what we're looking for.
I think the beauty of your project, Paul, is that as you continue to dream, and since it hasn't really started yet, is that you can really partner with many other people who maybe have had chances of starting something very similar or maybe in a smaller scale but would like to replicate. So is that something that you are interested in as well?
Yes, of course. As I said, I'd like to see, I see this project essentially as it's a blank canvas, right? That basically we can start this correctly from the very beginning. And I'd like to draw on all the experiences of all the other people who've done this kind of a project and apply it to our model as well.
That's great. That's really great. I think as long as you have the same passion to serve the people, the same desire to make things better in the area, to do reforestation, like you said, to improve the environment in the area and to include the communities there,
yes,
then you're off to the right start.
Well, as I said, this presentation that I make is just a start. Mm-hmm. It could be a lot more or bigger in scope. So as I said, there's a lot more that we can do. I know that there is a lot more that we can do in this area.
Okay, so from Paul's presentation, this is basically a showcase of what can be and a dream that Paul has. And it's a call out to all of you who are here in this group. And maybe a lot of you can be part of the implementation and how to see this dream come true. So thank you very much, Paul. I like the engagement in the chat box. Please keep it coming. Some people are already saying that they have started some similar projects and would like to help you out as well. So please go ahead, put that in the chat box. And maybe if you'd like to share also some of your experiences later on, we'll have that opportunity after all our sharers and all our speakers have given their presentations.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Paul. We'll have you again in a bit. Let's move to the second speaker. So from Paul's dream, we move now to something that has partly been implemented, but now wants to be replicated in something of a wider scale. So I would like to introduce to you our second speaker. Prasoon is the co-founder and CEO of Billion Bricks. He has received global recognition for his work, a President's Design Awardee, TEDx speaker, and social justice campaigner working towards eradicating homelessness. Prasoon began his career as an architect, working in design firms across India, USA, Hong Kong, and Singapore. And today we are blessed to have him with us as he shares his work here in the here in our country, the Philippines. So go ahead, Prasoon.
All right. Thank you, Jen. And thank you, ABS Foundation, for having me, and Gava Kalinga for letting me know of this event today. Looking forward to the discussion, and it was great to hear what Paul had to say and kick it off at such a high note. I'll probably spend a little bit of time talking about my background and what Billion Bricks really does and what are we trying to do in the Philippines. So like as Jen mentioned, my background is in architecture. I studied architecture in India. Then I worked in the United States, did a master's there. And over the 10 years period, I worked in a lot of commercial projects such as high-end residential projects, airport projects in India, super tall towers, which are more than 100 story tall, shopping malls, hospitals, large urban development projects. I worked in Manila on a super yacht terminal project and master planning project as well. So I did work across a lot of developing cities in 10 years of my career. But what I realized were three things in my professional career on the corporate side. Firstly, that I had designed over 10,000 homes for people like you and I, but a lot of architects and planners talk about providing homes to the homeless, and that never happens really. The number of projects that get done for the poorest of the poor are very, very small in number. The second reason is that I come from Delhi, and I've seen in the last 20 years how the wealth in developing cities, including like Manila and a lot of cities in the Philippines, has grown, but it has benefited the rich people like us. If you go out on the streets, you find that the poorest of the poor are much in a worse of condition. Cities like Manila have 30 to 35% people living in slums, more traffic congestion, more pollution, more safety issues. So while we've grown in as a society with more money, but our problems have increased and we haven't grown in a sustainable way. And that bothered me a lot. And the third thing that that really prompted me to start and found Billion Bricks was the fact that when you're in corporate, I think there are a lot of these forums where we go in and speak about doing good for the world and what is our responsibility and how as citizens, we need to come forward and do something. We need to form partnerships. We need to move forward step by step. But this is totally contrary to what we do in our day jobs in the corporate side, where we want to dominate the world. We want to move as fast as possible. We want to create change in our domain by not caring about the social and environmental good. And we do very little good, but we talk a lot about that good. So that that dichotomy in what we wish to do, but what we actually do, prompted me to say that, okay, I have to stop working on the corporate side. I have to stop speaking in these forums about doing good, but not really doing good, and really take action and see if it's even possible for someone like me to do something about it. So Billion Bricks was founded in 2013 as a nonprofit to say that we want to end homelessness in the world. And in our work around that area, today about more than 5,600 people in 8 countries live in shelters, which have been provided by us. It sounds could sound in this forum like a large number, but if you look at a global scale where about 1.8 billion people today need access to better homes, a number which will increase to about 3 billion by 2030, means that the work that people like us are doing is so minuscule that it's hardly making any change. So there's a lot more talk happening than real action. And that really was the core of for us to say that how can we move at a much, much faster pace in order to bring change. And what we realized is that the housing issue is really a reason, it has got three reasons behind it. The first one is disasters, which could be economic disasters, it could be environmental disasters, it could be natural disasters, which leads to people moving and losing their homes, and they are a lot of them are never able to recuperate and go back to having access to homes. So that was one. The second is the fact, which I think I want to talk about more here, is the rural development issues. So rural areas are not developing, and people have no incentive to live there if they want a good quality of life. and all the good work is happening in the cities, and people want to move into the cities to actually have a better life for themselves. So rural development is not happening. And in rural areas, we talk about empowering people and developing and skill development, but that's something that we don't want for our kids only. I mean, how many of us want our kids to go start doing agriculture, start doing fishing? So there's a, and it's the same ambition that people in rural areas have as well, to get their kids to the best schools, best education, work in the tech industry. And this whole change in empowering people in the rural areas while looking for something else in the urban areas is creating this change, which we are not able to solve. And the third real issue is that when people move from rural to urban areas, the urban areas are so darn expensive that even if they have access to jobs, they can't afford homes. So we said that if we can solve all these three issues, then we may have a stab at solving the housing crisis in the world. So in order to solve the rural issue, we came up with the idea to say that, okay, I mean, our expertise is in housing. I mean, we are not in job creation and income increasing. We don't want to be in that domain. Can we create homes that can actually generate additional income for the people themselves? So their incentive, where their quality of life actually drops, is much, much lower. At the same time, ownership of a home is something not easy. You and I can go to a bank and a bank will give us 20, 30 times more money than we, what we can afford. And an expensive house becomes affordable for us. But for the poor to even own a house, which is very, very cheap, like 500,000 pesos, is very hard because the banks would not trust them with that little amount of money. So we said that can we create this system of a house which generates its income and it then is used to finance the house, which creates people in its ability to own homes, live in communities which are safe, where they have access to better jobs, have access to education and healthcare, and bring a movement of these highly sustainable communities into the forefront. So before I go any further, I would show a video and then I'll conclude with what we are trying to do in the Philippines. Jen, can we have the video, please?
Amin sa kay Charla uto, sa kampo to, apanis, tada rangguli, mulela anggul galto sa arpar hindi to amin sa ipapar to sa talaga to nung wasta. Alay abdel lang malo kupa anand warto, sanglo warto, lekre sa ayza ta amin nung lasya ta zato. Tidar mul mansuri korto, mukti nung porat sande kay sa ala gari ito. Gari alar pa sa ipapani korto, jo to ablon aram korto.
Dito?
Aduh. Ada satu malam cak muli si kau dia nama malah file andar wata hilang tiket nuk di te cak mula am malah solar kara malah solar de. Cak mula di lete nata malah tak sanggup wat. Ami girni taku muli am best kerjaan. Muli sih ni sih cah ya, amci mulga apa enggak? Tapi pernah mentu muli sih tu apa lagi kali mulga muli sih dia mulai mulai sih.
Power Height is the first solar-powered, self-sufficient, self-financing and carbon-negative modular home. It is a radical concept in housing that is designed keeping in mind extreme scalability, affordability, and a sustainable future.
Am kya garam di char buli gani purai. Sak ye loka chawa uradu kam karalaku. Tapi pousa la tegala dai mati gala dai. Am di pumulo pon dopat musu kaja sapat jawata dai. Ye pailang am jadirat light nu ki. Ate sibile jilai naila pusu. Amala tanglo wat ber. Mati amala pusu.
So what you've seen here is in India, a prototype that we built a couple of years ago or a couple of months ago. But we also have two running prototypes of these homes in the Philippines, one in Tacloban and now one is in Cagayan de Oro, which I think is it will complete very, very soon. But if I break down the concept essentially is that every house, and when you club these houses together, it forms a community of homes which have a solar roof on them. But the solar roof is so large that it produces about 40 times more energy than what the community consumes in itself, which means it essentially becomes a large solar farm under which a community is living. When we sell this energy onto the grid to an industry or to a corporate or just to households like yours and mine, we generate additional income, which is used to cross-finance the cost of the homes. So we believe by this mechanism, and depending on what kind of partnerships and aid we can receive, we can actually now provide homes to people at a huge discount than what they would traditionally cost. What this would allow us to do is to not look for philanthropic money, but against our ability to sell the energy, we can go and raise capital from traditional financial institutions and build housing for the poorest of the poor, which until now has probably been impossible to be done. We think this is a very highly replicable model in rural areas where land is cheap, and we could replicate it very, very fast. So we actually partnered with Engie, which is world's largest private energy company, and a French company as well, earlier this year, to shift Billion Bricks from a nonprofit to a for-profit social enterprise now. And we are now looking to build the world's first such community in the Philippines, which will have a generation capacity of about 10 megawatts, will house about 500 homes, needs about 16 hectares of land, and the homes come with school, job opportunities, parks, and a safe environment for the community to live and thrive. The goal of Powerhide or these homes is actually not to provide just homes, but to bring people out of poverty in a single generation. And when we say bring people out of poverty, I'm not talking about incremental change to increase their incomes by a few hundred pesos or a few thousand pesos. We want to bring them up all the way to lower middle income bracket, at least, which would be higher than the average into the Philippines. The reason is that incremental change for the poor is too slow. We have to bring in disruptive change, put them into a future which is far more sustainable than what you and I live in. Their homes by doing this would be carbon negative homes, which means they'll fight climate change, they'll have access to energy, which you and I will not have in our homes itself. So we want to bring change at a very, very large scale, and we know that we cannot do it alone. So we are looking for partners in the Philippines. We are working very closely with Gawa Kalinga as we speak at the moment to try and build the first of these communities. But again, it's not possible to do this alone. So my call to action here is that we are looking for people who would want to buy energy from communities that we would build, partner with us, provide us access to land and funding to enable this to happen. And once we succeed, we'll scale it very, very large. And before I end, I forgot to mention in the beginning that we've had a great relationship with ABS-CBN Foundation, that we've actually provided some of our earlier work, which is through shelters, into the Philippines as well. So we are looking forward to building more and more relationships as we come deeper and deeper into the Philippines. Thank you for this opportunity. I'm happy to answer any questions. We have a large vision, but we are here to make that large vision reality along with all of you. Thank you.
Wow, I see a lot of heads nodding, Prasoon, as you were making your presentation. Some thumbs up sign as well. Paul really definitely kicked it up really well with his first presentation. And now this one with some of your prototypes already in place and seeing how it can be blown into. I love the word that you said. You said destructive change. And I think that's the kind of change the world is needing right now because of what we are facing. There are some questions I'd like to ask you now coming from the chat box. There's a question of what about houses that have already been built? Is there a way to pivot these houses, let's say GK houses, to experience also the solar generation that can be done using your technology?
So solar generation in existing houses is not hard. I mean, all you need is to put a solar panel and you can generate the energy. But these houses produce, like I said, a lot more energy than what they consume, which is then sold to generate additional income. And for that, we need to build new houses because that's an asset which has to be secured, which has to be insured, and which is something that we have to build and be confident would last for 25, 50 years in order for us to go and raise funding against that. If you do it on an existing home, then it's very, very difficult for us to go and actually raise money to solve the problem. The problem here we are solving is of building new homes, and it's not an energy problem or a climate change problem, which is the primary problem.
Okay, I'm not quite sure if it's my connection or yours, Prasoon, but just to synthesize what you answered is that it's essentially starting off with a new house. It's constructing new homes that you're looking for.
That's correct. I mean, the goal of this idea is to provide access to better homes to people who don't have homes. So mm-hmm. if we go and put it on existing homes, then I think it doesn't serve the primary purpose of the concept.
Okay. I just also want to find out what triggered, you mentioned in your presentation, you thought of the shift from a grant perspective to a impact investment kind of a shift in perspective in the way that you do things. Was there any particular moment or situation where that triggered that?
So it wasn't by design. I mean, when I founded Billion Bricks as a nonprofit, it wasn't because I wanted to do a nonprofit. It's just that I didn't know how can I can, while providing homes to some of the poorest communities in the world, how can I have a business model where I can also sustain myself? So as I worked on my nonprofit side for about 5 years, I came up with these more robust ideas where I thought that there's an opportunity for us to do a good social business as well while creating a positive social and environmental impact. And then I found someone who said, we'll give you money if you would go for profit. I mean, for me, as long as the mission does not get diluted, I don't think it matters whether we are doing it as a nonprofit or a for-profit. For us, what is critical is that scale is important. We don't want to be an organization which is doing 25, 50, 100, 1,000 homes. Philippines has a need of about 144,000 homes a year, has a backlog of 4 million homes. And this backlog's been increasing for decades. And I keep seeing these forums happening all over again and again, which just keep talking about bringing in change, but the change never comes. So we are trying to break that cycle of bringing in change.
And we do hope that this forum will also not just be about talk, but it will also be about action and partnerships. Where are you now in the project in the Philippines that you want to scale up your prototypes?
So we are early stage. We are looking to build the first project. We are looking for land, but we have a couple of partnerships on the land side already going. Like we are working with GK in Pampanga to actually work with the city to get land and access to a community. But I think what we really need is who's going to buy the energy from us. So we need customers like big shopping malls or industrial houses that have the capacity to take the energy that we'll generate, which will probably be around 2.5 to 10 megawatts of capacity that we will have to take that from us on a long-term power purchase agreement. I think once we have that secured, we can move very fast to bring in money and actually build the community.
I'm going to ask two questions coming from the chat box for soon. One is that, what are the challenges you're facing now as you aim to scale? So I think you partly answered that in terms of the what you just mentioned about the project in Pampanga, but maybe any other aside from the buyers of the energy that you will be producing?
Yeah, I think the biggest challenge we are facing is that anything which is new, I think, is or innovative, people generally have a lot more questions than answers for it and are not risk takers. So people want a very safe solution and they don't are not willing to come and say, okay, let's take this ride. We may fail or we may succeed, but unless we'll try or not do it. So I think for us to find champions who are saying that we'll take a bet on your idea because if it succeeds, it could transform, is I think the biggest challenge that we have at the moment. The second, I think, is with regards to moving fast enough, right? I think speed is critical for us to survive. I mean, we only have so much funds and resources with us as well. And it's important that we are able to move faster than slower.
There's another interesting question here. What is the model or the scheme on ownership and maintenance of the homes? Is there like a certain number of years and then you transition out? So maybe you can quickly explain on that as well.
Yeah, so I think ownership is critical, right? I mean, the purpose for us to make people homeowners is central to the idea. And so on day one, people become homeowners, but we own part of the house, which is the roof through which we can actually sell the energy. Once we exit the project, which we think will take probably about 20 to 25 years, then people own the entire house, including the rights onto their roof. But they have a house just like you and I have. So it's like a condominium where you can own a house, but there are certain parts where you have a limited control in that. We as an organization also take up the maintenance for that period of 20 to 25 years. So we maintain the solar panels, we maintain the roof, and we work with the community to maintain the community and grow it and ensure that it succeeds.
I think, Prasoon, in an earlier conversation, you also mentioned that within that period of 20 to 25 years, that's when you actually empower the community, take on other projects with them, not just in terms of housing, but other social concerns to build a resilient community. Are you also open to partnerships for, let's say, some people who are more focused and whose strengths are actually in that area?
That's correct. I think, I mean, that's a great question because essentially, I mean, constructing this, building it, financing this is only maybe a 2 or a 3 year period. The real fun of the project starts after it's been built, people are living there, how well can we take care of them? And that's where I think the opportunity, and I think, I mean, we should look at people as people, right? I mean, they are a human resource that we have access to. And then it's the time for all partners to come in and say, okay, how can we ensure that they have access to the best education, they have access to the best jobs, and within a year to 20 years, they can come out of poverty and have homes and lives just like you and I. I mean, they should be able to, if they want, sell this home, move to a better place, somebody else should come in and live there. It should just like be integrated to the society like anything else.
Thank you for that. I think there's some people who really are thinking, Prasoon, maybe if you would be open to some sort of model that, I don't know what kind of model that will be, but some sort of technology for all things already existing, because a lot of them are saying that they're already existing homes, but they're very interested on the other part of maybe energy generation using the homes that have already been built. I know you already mentioned that might be a mission drift or that might be hitting the primary mission that you have, but there seems to be some clamor on that. I think after seeing the design of your houses in the video, some actually are very interested. Also coming from a desire to just help energize more communities who probably have homes already.
Yeah, I mean, this is a strange question and has probably never been asked to me because this kind of goes to the heart of Billion Bricks to say, will you change your model and you'll become an energy company, right? I mean, there are so many players already in the Philippines who work in the sector of rooftop energy. Our goal is to ensure that the 144,000 people that you add every year that don't have access to homes get access to homes. I think that's where, I mean, without a home, you cannot build your lives. You can't protect your women. You can't provide education to children. You can't increase people's jobs. How do you change your economy from where you stand today to something else if you don't have access to homes? So that's the area where we are passionate about. I'm sure if there are opportunities for us to work on existing homes and it fits into our mission, then I mean, we are happy to look at that as well. But I think at the fly right now, when you've asked me this question a couple of times, I don't see a fit there. But if there's an opportunity, and I'm sure there are people who are very, very smart in this conversation, if they can see a link on how we could do that. I mean, we'll be very open. Our goal is to make sure that the community improves and there's no poverty in a country like Philippines.
Thank you, Prasoon. Thank you also admiring your conviction to stay within what you know is your strength and what you know is your real mission. Sometimes I think a lot of us in the NGO sector seem to just want to save everything and do everything, and maybe that can dilute one perspective of looking at this. Is it may dilute what your core strength can be. So we'll get back to Prasoon. There, I know light bulb moments. I see some light bulb moments now in the way the people are reacting to the presentation so far. So let's get the momentum going. So from the dream that Paul has and really the openness to collaborate to the wanting to replicate and create destructive change on a massive level from Prasoon's presentation. Now we're going to have another presentation. This one is from a more community perspective, something that has already happened, a model and a concept that was tried and for some years now is actually working. So this one is something from our side, from our end, we'd like to also share. I'd like to call on one of our site specialists working in our Yolanda areas, Aileen Caballero, showing also of what we call a model of, in Filipino, it's called Kaya Pala, Puede Pala, or in English, I will try to translate it as best I can. It's really a model that says it can be done. So it's a model of sustainable community development, and we'll start off with some videos.
Naalala ko nung nanalasa ang bagyong Yolanda, isa ang aming pamilya sa mga nasalanta. nagtago kami sa gilid ng eskwelahan. Pagkatapos ng bagyo, umuwi kami sa aming bahay at walang natira sa amin. Pero unti-unting nagbago ang buhay namin noong natuto kaming alagaan ang kalikasan. Natuto kaming magkaisa at sama-samang paunlarin ang aming magandang bayan ng Dulag.
Noong bagyong Yolanda, mga 4 years ago, isa ang Dulag Leyte sa pinaka-apektado na lugar noong bagyo. So nawala ng bahay, walang trabaho, walang pagkain. Maraming mga organization na tumulong at isa doon ang Sagip Kapamilya at Bantay Kalikasan. Yung mga army tumutulong sa construction, yung LGU, lahat ng permits tinulungan kami. Si DNR, tinulungan kami magtanim ng puno. So during the response, Dulag was given different kind of livelihood projects. And isa na yun is the Sabang Dagitan Surf Camp. Meron din tayong San Jose Skim Boarding Camp, the Obalay Kawilan, and 7 different farms. So isa ito sa pinaka-successful na proyekto na ginawa ng Bantay Kalikasan. Before mag-Yolanda, the whole place is bare. Walang puno, walang bahay, walang tao. Pero ngayon, with their volunteerism, pagsisikap nila, sila mismo nagtatrabaho, nagbo-volunteer, walang sweldo, sila lahat nag-build ng structures na to. Till now, naging 15 pesos per hour. What's amazing about these people is nagsimula sila sa konti lang, pero ngayon, using their income, nagpapatayo sila ng sariling cottages, information, office, guardhouse. Bumili sila lahat ng gamit ng kusina, video kit, freezer, lahat ng kailangan namin sa kusina na bili na nila.
Pero nakikita namin yung mga bangka dyan. Meron po ba dito na gano'y nangingisda?
Yes po, lahat ng community natin dito, farmers, senior citizen, at saka mga fishermen. So, pag nag-duty sila in the morning, sa gabi naman sila nangingisda. Pag nag-duty sila in the evening, morning naman sila nangingisda.
Wow.
So, hindi pa rin nila iniiwan yung pangingisda nila. And then, yun yung part ng BK, i-organize mo ang buong community, i-empower mo sila from fisherman to chairman of the board, from nanay to head of the restaurant, from fisherman to head of the security.
Nice.
And now for 2 years, kaya-kaya na nilang gawin yun on their own.
Right. My name is Jen. Good morning, everyone. I will be sharing to you the success of Sabang Dagitan Surf Camp as a model of sustainable community development. Sabang Dagitan Surf Camp is a social enterprise. They are composed of an association of farmers, fishermen, surfers, and senior citizens turned into a cooperative. They have 202 members, 70 employed staff. They're an agri-ecotourism site. They have a farm-to-table restaurant, an organic farming, floating cottages with spa. They also have surfing, glamping, kayaking, and now they're an agri-learning center. The mission of Bantay Kalikasan is to make every Filipino a steward of the environment. We wanted to create a loving,
go ahead, Aileen. We'll have your slides back up, but go ahead and continue with your presentation, please.
The Bantay Kalikasan wanted to create a loving and happy community. And for us, implementing these projects, we follow pillars we believe made Sabang Dagitan Surf Camp a sustainable social enterprise and an empowered community. So these are the pillars. First, we have environmental stewardship, empowered communities, governance, and leadership We have sustainable livelihood and building networks and ecosystems. Next, please. Our priority in Bantay Kalikasan is the protection and conservation of the environment. We have projects in different provinces all over Philippines, and we conduct environmental activities based on the need of the project. Like in Sabang Dagitan, we planted thousands of beech trees like Malabago and Talisay seedlings after Typhoon Yolanda. We do beach and river cleanup every week. We have an NRF, we have organic farming. But now, like doing the drive, like beach cleanup drive and river cleanup drive every week, the community knows the importance of keeping the beach clean. So every day they're doing it before they start, the surfers, before they start their work, they would clean the whole beach every morning. So we do not have to do any drive anymore every week. So we're facing a lot of environmental issues in our community, in our projects. We have mining in Manikani. We have illegal logging in Parana, Samar. And in Sabang Dagitan, it used to be dynamite fishing. And also before Yolanda, it's mining of black sand. But now providing them a sustainable livelihood, which is our second pillar, it addresses environmental issues. Since they have a regular job, a monthly salary that can feed their children, pay for the tuition, then they don't have to go dynamite fishing anymore. And it addresses other issues like poverty and unemployment. And for us to keep the enterprise sustainable, we also have, next slide please. We also have governance and leadership. This pillar refers to the ability of the community to govern themselves, to achieve common goals. Like I remember when we started in Sabang, I let every community have a meeting. I mean, I let every department have a meeting every week, and then a special meeting every month with the board of directors and the head of department. And all of them are complaining, why do you have to do this meeting? And after a year, they were able to understand it. Now they have this so-called Monday assembly. Every morning they have a flag ceremony, and then all the department heads will give updates, provide information for the next activities, if there are trainings or issues with the operations, and then they'll do Zumba afterwards. So they'll be able to start their week. So I think it really helps with this kind of huddle. And also for us to develop the capacity of the leaders, it ensures community participation. That's why we also believe that building networks and ecosystem is also important. This refers to the linkages and access of different partners that will provide training and assistance suitable for the project. Like Sabang won the BPI Scenic Award. Bayan Academy gave them training on manicure and pedicure, since they have a floating cottages with spa. Visayas State University had a signed MOA this month to help them with assistance on agri-learning center and extend the demo farm. Also, Leyte Normal University and Eastern Visayas State University have been our partner for more than 3 years. They made Sabang Dagitan the extended community outside of school. And like ATI and TESDA and Department of Agriculture helped us with the documents on becoming an agri-learning center. So these four pillars, we believe that it really contributed in empowering the community. And how do we empower the community? That is through community organizing. Community organizing, or the site specialist, or we call the community organizer, plays a vital role in facilitating the whole community process. I remember when Gina Lopez told us, you have to live with them, you eat with them, you sleep with them, be one of them. We thought that she was just joking. We don't understand everything about it. But now living with the community, or what we call community immersion, allows you to gain better knowledge of the people and their situation to achieve a solution to the problem. And also, it mutually develop a good relationship to the community. So we believe that if an organizer listens, has a big eyes for serving, a big ears for listening, and you have to be patient to the community, you guide the leaders, then gradually you will be able to lead the community more empowered, to achieve independence and self-reliance. So that's what we believe in our work. There's still a lot of room for us to learn, but these pillars will help us with empowering our community. Next, please. Next. So from our grand launch was October 2015. We started our operation in 2016. We've earned 4.9 million. In 2017, we earned 6.4, and 2018, we earned 6.7, and last year, we just earned 8 million, and it doubles our traffic from 2016 to 2019, but now it's pandemic. Our estimated target of our sales would be 10 million or more, but we'll get through this since we have not opened for 4 months. And that's it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Aileen. You know, to everybody who's here, and I know it's already lunchtime, but I do hope that you find these conversations engaging, that you'll stay with us for a few more minutes, because there's really so much to be learned from all of our speakers this morning. Aileen, how are they doing now? As you said, we are in a pandemic. Tourism is one of the badly hit industries and sectors. How are they doing now? What is the kind of pivot that they need to do?
Yes, we opened last August 1st, and we have to follow protocols. So we have to reduce our number of guests. We took some certificates, and we have to follow like the mask, using PPEs and face shields. So we have to follow all the protocols of the local government of Bulacan and Department of Tourism. But Sabang Dagitan is a big enterprise. It's a big area. For month of August, we've earned 400,000, and this month of September, we've earned half a million. That's only half of the guests we only allow.
Are there other projects that the community is also doing to sort of like augment the gaps now produced by the lack of ecotourism?
Yes, we're more online now. So we deliver our flat-patted herbs, our vegetables, our basil shake, and all the food in our restaurant. So basically more on online.
And Aileen, I think from your sharing, you really spent a lot of time on community empowerment. And I think from Prasoon's conversation a while ago, where he said that really the behavior change and sort of like allowing people to take the journey of risk-taking. How was that experience for you as a community developer and organizer? How was that for you with Sabang Dagitan?
Well, like it said, community immersion is really important because you get to know the people. If you do not live with them, or you don't get to know the people, you will not be able to understand their problem and how to resolve this issue. Because actually, us are only guiding them. The the one who can solve their issue is the community. It's just that they need to be socially prepared. They need capacity building. They need to be, of course, they will be shy at first, and they don't have the confidence of operating and of the social enterprise, because they would always say that I'm a elementary graduate, or just a grade one, grade two elementary graduate. So, I mean, community organizing, that's really important for us. The partner helping the community, provide them on financial literacy, on trainings that they need, and then afterward, after a few months, then they will be able to know their self-worth. They will be confident to operate the enterprise.
I think that's a beautiful word that you just said there, Aileen, self-worth. It's journeying with them for them to discover that there is so much more that can be done. How long did it take for you to gain their trust, for you and them to see that this is really a journey that has to be done together?
It takes time. You know, I could say maybe a year. I mean, they do not understand why do you have to do organic farming. We can use all these chemicals, so we'll have a bountiful harvest. Why do we have to segregate these plastics? All of that. But based on my experience, what the community really wants is they want action. Even if you provide them all the training and they will just sit down and listen to the trainer, what they want is to see action. So you have to do it first. Even if I'm not an agriculturist, I plant. Even if I don't have other experience with community organizing, I make sure that me first will be the role model for Sabang. So you have to do it on your own. You show them what it's like, and then they will realize that how important to keep the beach clean. Why we have to plant trees? I remember when we were planting trees, ma'am. Why do we have to plant all these trees when it will all gonna die because of the wave? But now we planted like almost 3,000 talisay trees now.
So I think, you know, one of the things that they probably saw in you, Aileen, is really the authenticity, to be one with them, with a mission. And I think that goes, that translates and transcends whatever can be that cultural divide. So we are actually having this forum from everywhere. Aileen is coming in from Ormoc. Prasoon, I think, is coming in from Singapore, if I'm not mistaken. Paul is, I think, in Metro Manila, but soon to go also to Samar. So we will now open the conversation, and we're going to have a gallery view so that we can see each other as well, because we have some questions also coming in. And after hearing all of the three speakers, we'd like to hear from you as well, from all our other participants here, for other questions that you can address to any of our speakers, and to all of them, if it's something that you'd like to also address to all of them. So, Mick, is it possible to have the discussion and put everybody on gallery just so we can see each other? There you go. You know, sometimes it's really better to be able to see the person you're talking to, even on a digital space. All right. So anybody who'd like to start the discussion rolling, I have some questions though, and maybe I can start with that. Aileen, what about organic farming? Is that present now in the community?
Yes. Yes, Ms. Jen. All of our sites are into organic farming. It could be a small site. We could do a vertical farming. So that's really one thing that we wanted to apply in our project in organic farming.
Okay, I have another question. And I guess I would like to invite everybody who's here in the forum to please go ahead, type in your questions in the chat box. If you do want to address the speakers yourselves, please do let us know, and we'd call on you to be able to address the speakers yourselves. There has been
quite a mention of partnerships and collaboration. So this is a question I'd like to address to all three speakers. How do you make partnerships and collaborations work?
I mean, partnerships and collaborations are like dating, right? So it takes a lot of effort and time, and I think that's one of the reasons I've lost my hair as well. So it needs a lot of effort to be put in. And I think eventually what matters is, are we aligned? Because everyone has their own individual goals, while we may have a collective goal as well. So is our collective goal aligned, and are we able to meet our individual goals that we have? And I think once the stars line up, I think a project works. And generally it's not easy, and it's a time consuming effort. And that's why I think partnerships and collaborations are essential, but they're also very expensive. So the more things that we can do on our own, the faster we can move. And I think once you're big and you're strong, I think partnerships and collaborations are much, much easier.
Thank you, Prasoon. Yes, it does take time and there are challenges. Can we hear from Paul?
Yeah, just what Prasoon was saying. I think, as I said, it has to start with the alignment of objectives and sharing of ideas and thoughts. And then secondly, I think, at least in our case, I think we'd like to start by, as Eileen was saying, I think it's has to be done through action first. And then we can show the people, at least around the area, or you know, possible collaborators that, you know, if we start it first and it can be done, then people will come along and follow you and collaborate with you.
Eileen, would you like to add anything else?
Yes, Ms. Jen. With our project, Ms. Jen, we need to make sure that the community or the social enterprise is active. And then that's where all the partnership comes. Because like a government agencies, if they see that the Farmers Association or these vendors or the fishermen are active and they know they're investing, they are empowered, then they go directly to us. We don't need to ask for their partnership anymore because they see that the project is successful or the association or the cooperative is active.
So I see some common answers in your sharing. One is that you have to start it off, get the ball rolling, get something done, and then organically, partnerships and collaborations may work. Prasoon mentioned that it takes time, a lot of conversations, a lot of alignments. You need to convene all the time and talk about it. There was a very good suggestion, actually, Paul, that came up in the chat box after your presentation. Two people were actually saying, what about if you may actually initiate a call for partners forum, maybe in the area of Samar, like, try to gather people who are actively working already in Samar and maybe initiate a partners forum. Do you think that's something that can be done?
Actually, that's what we wanted to do in the near future. And I think that with this forum, with the GK, I think it just accelerated it. So we'll be doing that in a very near future from now. Yes, definitely.
We have about 90 people in this group. So for you who are a part of organizations working in the areas of Samar, and Paul, one of those organizations will be us. Okay. If you are present in this area, please go ahead and feel free to reach out to Paul. It's a white canvas stage. Yes. for that project, and that's very exciting. All of the email addresses of our speakers are in the chat box. You can go ahead and reach out to us as well if you want to get in touch with them. It seems to be that the entry point for all three are different. Prasoon, it's housing. For Paul, it's really more of the climate change and the climate mitigation solutions using the forest. For Eileen, it's also the environment. But we've seen, whether it's on a theoretical model or what's already happening now, that eventually it will cut across other social issues and concerns. Is that purposive on your end or something that you think is organically done?
So, I mean, in my opinion, I mean, the way Billion Bricks works is that I think we believe in a very sharp focus and doing one thing right and not spreading ourselves too thin. And I think this is counterintuitive to the social sector, where you earlier did mention that we generally try and do too much, right? So when we go into, say, a rural development thing, people ask us about empowerment, about jobs, about water, about climate change, about environment, housing, education, school. So the expectation is like as if we are a large government. And if governments are so unsuccessful, then I think it begs the question whether it's physically possible to do or not. And I think this is one of the reasons why the social sector moves much slower than the private sector, because in private sector, people are very sharply focused. If I want to sell Coca-Cola, I just care about Coca-Cola. I don't care about diabetes, about plastic. All that is secondary to me. And in our case, I think we need to be similarly focused, and then other things will happen on their own. And we need to trust people that they'll bring about that change. And we can look at ourselves as well. I mean, the fact that you and I could get good education and that empowered us to get better jobs and create a better house for ourselves and everything, and we could do it. So I think when we talk about too much handholding, I think we should probably stay away from that.
Okay, sharp focus is Prasoon's perspective. And again, it's something quite different from what a lot of social organizations are doing. What about you, Paul?
I think as what Prasoon was saying on the private sector side, I think he's right with the focus. But also, at least I think on our model, as I said, you know, we'd like to do it first on our own. Like we have 3,600 hectares. So what we're going to do is do it face by face. So we'll do the first parcel of 200 hectares and focus on what we think we should be doing, and then grow it from there organically, step by step. I think that's what we should be doing on our end. Yeah.
Okay, so you have your general framework, but put it into bite-sized pieces, I suppose, so, and doable, yes. More manageable. What about in Bantay Kalikasan?
We'll do it one at a time. We have already a few, we have successful projects, so we'll replicate it, and then we'll be able to have a lot more projects like Sabang Dagit and Surcam.
So I think the perspective also is very to enter with an environmental KPI, to stick to that first, and everything else becomes a strategy towards that. So a lot of, I know Paul is really focused in the Basay area. What about you, Prasoon and Aileen? There are questions of, are you present in any other area in the Philippines? Or maybe you can just quickly run through the areas or regions where you are at.
Yes, we have a surfing community in Sorsogon. We have in Palawan. We also have in Sarangani. And in summer, we have a lot like Piranhas Eco Trail, the Lulugayan Falls in Calbiga. We have Spotton Cave in Basay. We have in Batangas. And other more provinces, a lot to
mention. Yes, I know. So for those who would want to get to know more about the ABS-CBN Foundation areas of interventions, please go ahead and catch us on our website. We are actually present from up north down to the Barm area as well. So what about you, Prasoon?
For us, I mean, Billion Bricks is headquartered in Singapore, and for us, I mean, we want to solve the problem globally. We think it's essential for someone to come in and look at that scale. But for us, our first 200 hectares is the Philippines. In Philippines, currently we are focusing in Manila and a radius of about 3 to 4 hours outside of Manila to do the first community. We are in conversation in Davao, in Negros, around Cebu as well for potential projects. But we think that the concept is quite scalable throughout the Philippines as well. So we are very openly looking at the entire Philippines.
Okay, so again, that's an open invitation for all. And just to also quickly end this and wrap it up, we've heard so many good insights so many things that are triggering ideas. I know from your end, wherever you are, maybe in the country or maybe outside the country, but I think the common messages that we have received from all our speakers is that let's not forget to dream. And we need to dream so much more now when we are in this situation. Dreaming will and implementing will have to require some collaboration and partnerships. This is a general call out to align, to look at where we can come together. I like the conversation about really doing some action. For after you dream, you need to dare and you need to do. Because dreams, if dreams do not translate to action, then they just remain to be dreams. So the move is to dare and to do. The focus on your strength and the knowledge of what you're good at. The need to move progress, not just in urbanized areas, but most specifically in rural areas where we can include more people, include the community. It's a journey with them to see things from their perspective and not from ours alone. The importance of behavior change to take the risk and to really involve grassroots initiatives. So a lot to take in, but I know that in your hearts and in your minds, it's also you're here because you believe in the same things. We just go through it in different paths, but the final outcomes are very similar and the same. So thank you very much, but please don't leave yet. We have some very, very important reminders coming from our organizers. So again, the call to action is to collaborate, partner, get to know. Please reach out. Reach out to Paul, reach out to Prasoon, reach out to Eileen, because there is a lot of things that we can do together, whether it's on a funding level, on a connection level, a livelihood level. Skills, capacity, building, reach out. To all the participants, please don't forget to eat lunch. We all need to take care of ourselves, but we need to be back at the main plenary by 1:15. The recording of this breakout session will be uploaded and will be shared via the 30.org website. And please go ahead, and this is an open invitation to support Filipino community social enterprises. When it's safe to do so, go ahead and travel to Samar, go ahead and travel to Leyte, and visit the community-based social enterprises that you can find there. And there's a request from our organizers, if we can have a group photo. So if we can please put our videos on, you know, you never know. The great big destructive project and change may just be starting right now with this group of people right here. Okay, so you need to smile quite a few for quite some time because there are four panels that we need to go through. So, and I am hoping somebody's taking the picture while I smile. Okay. Let's keep on smiling, and then our millennials will tell me when it's time to stop smiling. Okay, I can also take the picture. Let's move to the second panel. Thank you. Ang ganda ng mga backgrounds. Iba-iba. Just really shows the diversity of the group that we have here. Okay, so thank you very much. Thank you for the beautiful smiles, and may we not stop smiling for the rest of the day as we continue to be inspired, as we continue to be inspired to move, to dream, to dare, and to do. So in behalf of ABS-CBN Foundation and all of the partners of this seminar, of this forum, we'd like to say, keep the hope up, and let's continue to pass on the hope to others. Thank you very much, and have a blessed day, everybody.
Thank you. Thanks, thank everyone. You.
Bye-bye. Bye. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Well, thank you sa lahat.
Thank you, Eileen.
Thank you.
Salamat. Thank you, speakers.
Thank you.
Thank you po.
Thank you po.
Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. Thank you, Prasoon. Thank you, Eileen.
All right. Thank you, guys. Bye-bye.
Thanks, Paul.
Thank you, Paul. Prasoon. I hope you had a great time.
Thank you, Paul.
Thanks, everyone. Thank you so much to the speakers. And thank you, Ms. Jen.
Thank you.
To me, Cha, and
hi, Fab. You're still here, Fab.
Thank you.
Oh, yep, you're moving around.
I heard about what's happening in your session.
And
I saw how jam-packed it was. So congrats, guys. I'm super happy that you're joining the 3-0 family. Thank you for putting this session together.
Always glad to help. And we hope to continue the conversations with all of you guys. Huh? This is not the end of it. This is the beginning.
It's just an excuse to get together. Promise.
Yes. Yeah. And thumbs up to the ABS-CBN Foundation Group. They're really great. They help us in everything.
Full force.